Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Winecast. I got a nudge from a viewer to consider doing casts on both port and sherry, both of which I've wanted to do for a while. Why haven't I? Well, both of these wines are actually quite complicated, each having a complex production method and a dizzying variety of styles to its name, and I haven't felt like I've had the time to tackle what I was sure would become a two-part cast each. Fortunately, I have a little time on my hands because of the holidays, and that seemed like a good opportunity to tackle at least one of these, so I went with port. I was right about the two parts, though, and in this first cast on port, I'll just have an opportunity to talk about the terroir, grapes, and vinification method associated with this wine, while part two will be about aging and the many and varied styles of port that are available. We have a lot to talk about, so let's get started. So what exactly is port? At its heart, it's a fortified wine that's specific to a region in Portugal. Fortified wines are wines that have had a distilled spirit added to them, either before or after the base wine has fermented to dryness. Alcohol is a preservative, and the technique of adding distilled alcohol to wines has its origin in reducing the risk of spoilage and otherwise protecting the wine, especially if it was meant to travel a long distance as an export. The specific port style of fortified wine probably dates to the 1600s, with the earliest known reference to wines made in this style coming from 1675. And what is the style? Well, ports are usually red, and since the distilled spirit is usually added before the wine has fermented to dryness, they're sweet as well. But there are dry ports out there, as well as white and rosé examples. Though, sadly, you'll see the name port on wine bottles from all over the world that make a fortified wine in the style I described. True port is very much connected to a place. Three places, actually, and it's worth saying a little bit about each of them. First, there's the city of Porto. A name that means port, as in seaport in Portuguese, that you'll occasionally hear called O Porto, that just means the port. Porto, located on the north coast of Portugal, is important because, as the site of export for this wine, it ended up giving its name to the style. Porto was the export location for the wine because historically, and still to a large degree today, the wine was aged in warehouses called lodges, yes, that's an English word, thanks to the important role that the British played in popularizing this style, that were located across the Douro River from Porto in the town of Vila Nova do Gaia. But though they were aged in Vila Nova, the site of their production was about 40 miles or 60 kilometers up the river in the Douro Valley. The Douro Valley was officially demarcated as a wine region in 1756 under the guidance of a Portuguese nobleman, the Marquis of Pombal, who was also Prime Minister of Portugal at the time. The Douro is one of the oldest officially designated regions for wine production in Europe, with only the Chianti zone in Italy and Hungary's Tokaji region having been demarcated earlier. It's divided into three sub-regions, moving from west to east up the river. They are the Baixo Corgo, or the area below the Corgo River, one of the tributaries of the Douro, the Cima Corgo, the area above the Corgo River, and the Douro Superior, or the Upper Douro. East of the Douro Superior is Spain, where the river has its source and is known as the Duero, as in Ribera del Duero. The climate here is continental, thanks both to its inland location and to the mountain range at the west end of the region, the Serra do Marau, that shelters it from the maritime influences that the more coastal areas of Portugal see. Though overall the climate for the region is continental, that is, having a cold winter and a long hot summer growing season, there's a fair amount of climatic variation within the region, with the general trend being that the farther east you go towards Spain, the hotter and drier the climate gets. The Douro is a river valley with steep slopes surrounding the river, meaning that vineyards can be planted at a number of elevations, and this also makes for variations in climate based on the location of a specific vineyard site. Being the coolest and wettest of the three subregions, the Baixo Corgo is known for wines that have a relatively light character, while in the warmer and sunnier regions to the east, where getting the grapes very ripe can be very easy, the wines express in a fuller and richer way. Things can get so warm and sunny, in fact, that in these regions, particularly in the Douro Superior, some growers plant their vineyards on the north slopes of a hill as opposed to the south slopes to help cut down on the amount of direct sunlight that the grapes get. Still, both of these regions, the Cima Corgo and the Douro Superior, are generally regarded as the regions containing the top vineyard sites, with the Cima Corgo being more heavily planted than the Douro Superior. All of these subregions are hill country, and most of the vineyards are on retaining wall-supported hillside terraces called socalcos. You can see socalcos pictured on the right, and it should be obvious that viticulture like this isn't friendly to mechanical harvesting. Though in recent years, new planting systems without either the terracing or the retaining walls, and that consequently can be harvested mechanically, have increased in popularity, though these new systems run the risk of damage on account of soil erosion. Speaking of the soil, the major type throughout the area is a combination of schist and granite, and thanks to fractures in the schist bedrock of the area, vines were able to sink their roots down to access underground water, making viticulture possible at all. There are actually dozens of grapes approved for port production, but the following five have become particularly important and make up most of the new plantings in the area. They are Touriga Nacional, Touriga Franca, that you might hear called Touriga Francesa, Tinta Rorige, which is just Tempranillo under another name, Tinta Barroca, and Tinta Cao. The most important grapes for making white port, again from a large number of permitted grapes, are Govejo and Malvasia Fina. The varieties that are used in port will also turn up in unfortified wines from the Douro region. So, how is port actually made? Port is fortified, but before fortification, the grapes are crushed and then undergo a very brief fermentation, about 24 to 36 hours. So, a day to a day and a half. Since the partially fermented must will then be run off the skins and fortified, that 24 to 36 hour window of time is the only opportunity to extract flavor, pigment, and other phenolic compounds from the skins. So, techniques have had to be developed to maximize extraction. The oldest and still considered most effective of these is foot treading. Yep, straight out of I Love Lucy stuff. It's a pretty straightforward process in which the grapes are placed in large and shallow granite troughs called lagares, and then stomped more or less continuously during the fermentation. The stomping actually takes place in two separate forms. The first, called the corte or the cut, involves a row of treaders linked together arm in arm, treading from one end of the lagar to the other, to perform an initial crush of the grapes. Then, after the grapes have been crushed, comes the liberdade, or liberty, because the treaders are now free to move around the lagar on their own, essentially to perform a constant punch down of the grapes to keep a cap from forming and to keep the skins and juice in constant contact. The treaders, who work in shifts during this process, can also use wooden paddles to help them punch the skins down. Though this process used to be universal and is still regarded as a best practice, it's labor-intensive and thus expensive, and its use has become more and more exclusive to smaller producers or reserved for top-quality wines. More common these days is a process called auto-vinification that deserves a closer look. Also known as the Du Cellier system for its creator, or as the Algerian Du Cellier system for its early use in that country's wine industry, auto-vinification is essentially an automated form of pumping over, but without using external power and relying instead on the CO2 generated by the fermenting grapes to move things around, making it very cost-effective. The process goes something like this. Crushed grape must is added to a sealed concrete tank through a portal and left to begin fermentation. As pressure builds in the tank, the must is pushed up through a pipe that dumps the must into an open trough connected to the main tank through a drain. As pressure decreases in the main tank with the escape of the must and CO2 out through the pipe, must from the trough above the tank is pulled down the drain and sucked up into the tank to start the process over again. At peak performance, that is when fermentation is in full swing, the entire volume of fermenting must in the tank can be pumped over 3 or 4 times an hour, all without having to rely on electrical power. Though auto-vinifiers are impressive, they're generally not thought to yield the same level of quality as foot treading. So what to do? How about developing robotic foot treaders? More and more producers are using systems like this that essentially automate the process with mechanical plungers, some of which are actually built to simulate the shape and contours of the human foot. Some critics, though not all of them, regard it as delivering the same level of quality as foot treading, and while the process is less labor-intensive than traditional treading, there's still a lot of costs involved in setting up and using the technology, so its current use tends to be for top-quality production. After crushing and extraction comes fortification. What's involved in that? Well, fortification is done when the alcohol in the fermenting must reaches about 5 to 9% of total volume, meaning that there's usually a fair amount of sugar left in the must. A distilled grape spirit called aguardiente, or burning water, is added to the must to bring the total alcohol by volume up to around 19 to 22%. But the aguardiente by law can only be a maximum of 77% alcohol itself. So to get the 19 to 22% alcohol by volume that producers are looking for, you need to add a fair amount of the stuff, with the result being that about 20% of a given port by volume will be made up of added distilled spirit. After fortification comes aging, but that's something we'll be saving for part two. Thanks for joining me for another Winecast. Part two is going to cover the peculiar classification system used for port estates, and then talk about aging and the variety of styles that result from the way in which a port is aged. That should be my next cast, so keep an eye out for it. If this cast was helpful and enjoyable, I hope you'll please like it and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And as always, I hope to hear from you in the comments. I'm your host, the Unknown Winecaster, and I'm out. Enjoy the grape, but always enjoy it responsibly.